that you are willing to discuss.
Yes.
And this discussion should be based on...
Yeah,
brother, please. This discussion should be based upon knowledge rather than ignorance. We agree with that, right?
Well, it depends what you mean by knowledge rather than ignorance. Again,
okay.
A very general...
So, if we both discuss this subject that you have on your hand,
yes,
upon ignorance,
yes,
do you think the discussion will be beneficial?
Well, in order to not be ignorant of the subject, we've got to understand the context. And the tafsir is what the Quran is talking about with the soul. Do you agree?
I misunderstood what you said. What I was asking you is this. If the discussion between both of us,
yes,
on the subject that you have here,
yes,
on your clipboard.
I mean, necessarily the subject as such, it's just something that when I was reading the Quran, I came across it.
Yeah, whatever you've got there in your piece of paper. Laminated, right?
Laminated piece of paper.
Good.
Yeah,
if we were to discuss this upon ignorance,
yes,
the discussion wouldn't be very beneficial. Do you agree?
I would like to have this conversation again with a Christian camera here, because there's 1, 2, 3, 4 Islamic cameras and I know exactly what
happened to your Christian cameraman? Why did he flee?
No idea.
That's not my problem, is it?
What do you mean it's not your problem?
If you want to go...
Can you guarantee that nothing can be snippeted out of these videos?
Look, ask those cameramen whatever you want to request of them. Go on.
And that request isn't necessarily going to be...
Well, look, if you have issues of cameramen doing something, go and ask them.
Do you mean go and ask them?
They're here, waiting for you to...
Could you to them, because they're most likely not going to...
Why am I going to ask cameramen? They're just the ones recording Speaker's Corner.
Yes,
right?
They're recording Speaker's Corner.
Right. So, you are still not sure, about the discussion should be proceeding upon ignorance.
I know my questions, and you're just going around here, there, ignorance,
okay,
knowledge. Why can't we just have a discussion and we see where it goes?
Why
is it not as easy as that?
Does the Quran say that if the Quran had been from any other than God, surely
in
they
Surah
would find...
In Surah 82, that's exactly what it says.
What does it say?
It says, do not reflect on the Quran that it be from anyone other than Allah, there are certainly found in it many inconsistencies. I accept that, that's what I'm going to believe.
Right. So, are there any inconsistencies within the Quran?
According to who?
According to Muslims, no. According to you?
How do you define inconsistency? And how does the surah define inconsistency?
Yeah, sure. An inconsistent, ikhtilafan here in the Quran.
Is that what it is now?
The Quran is not in English, do you agree?
I agree, but there's linguists who translate it into English. But I trust the linguist translation.
Which translation do you trust? Do you trust Palmer's translation or Arbery's?
Either.
Either? Are you sure? What if I find that between them there's a contradiction in what they say?
Are they both Qurans?
Translations
of the Quran.
Yeah.
And they both say two different things.
Sometimes they do.
Same message.
Sometimes they do.
Same message.
No, sometimes they do.
Separate messages, two Qurans, different messages.
Translations are only approximations,
right,
of the meaning of the Quran, as yep, much as they're able to express in the languages they're translating,
right,
and it demonstrates also the ability they have in translating the language they're translating from, Arabic.
Right.
Right. Not all translators have of the same capacity and capability.
Meaning that, okay, so the translators I trust are the ones that have had a certified degree in linguistics.
Very good. So which one is that?
What do you mean which one is that?
Which translation is that?
Any translation which has a debatably good level of linguistical ability.
Fine.
That understands Arabic very well, that understands the other language very well,
okay,
and that is able to translate,
okay,
between the two.
So the translation by Muhammad Sarwar.
Right. And what has he done? Who is he? Is he a doctor?
I'm asking you.
Right.
Do you know whether he is fulfilling the criteria that
one,
you have?
One, I don't know who he is. Two, I don't know where he studied. And three, could you tell me a little bit about him?
Fair enough. That's what I'm trying to get at.
Very good.
So which translations have you looked at and you consider them to be acceptable?
So I went on to sunnah.com, which is an Islamic website where I got this hadith,
Remember, we are talking about the Quran
and
translation,
the Quran,
right?
And from the Quran, I went
so,
to an Islamic source.
So which translations of the Quran do you think is acceptable?
Do I think is acceptable? I don't care what's acceptable to me, what's acceptable to you. I'm not a Muslim. I don't go by the Quran,
so,
I go by my own scriptures.
So any translation of the Quran is acceptable to you?
What do you mean to me? I'm not a Muslim.
So what you have here, is that a translation or the Arabic?
That's the translation of the Arabic.
Right. Is that acceptable to you?
It is acceptable to me.
Why?
Yes, it isn't acceptable to
now,
me.
No, why is it acceptable to
why
you?
Why is it acceptable to me? It's acceptable to me because I went round to separate different Muslims, asked them to look this up on their devices to see if it matches exactly what they say on their own Quran, and they say yes.
No, I want to understand. You have a translation in your hand.
I have a translation of the Quran.
And you consider it to be acceptable.
And I consider it to be
is
acceptable.
This translator
yes.
someone who has a degree in the language?
Well, I trust Tafsir Ibn Abbas. I trust Ibn Abbas to get the Tafsir of the Surah, yes.
That's what I'm asking you.
Then what are you asking me?
I'm asking you
yes.
the translation that, yes. are you, that you are using.
Yes.
By who is it, first of all?
By who is it, first of all? No idea.
No idea. Okay, fair enough.
But so which is why I ask every single Muslim.
Listen.
Sorry. Which is why I ask every single Muslim to check this up on their Quran and their devices
sure.
to see if it matches up.
Right.
And they will say themselves.
Very good.
Not accepted.
Remember what you said.
Yes.
Any translation.
Yes.
Has to be done by a linguist.
Yes, a linguist.
And now you have a translation.
I have a translation.
Which is laminated.
Yes.
And you have no idea who translation is done by.
What do you mean I don't know who it's done by? Would you like me to search up who it's done by?
No, the translation that you have here, laminated.
I have here, yes.
I ask you again, who is it by?
Would you like me to search up who it's by?
No.
I've got the source on here.
You've already laminated it.
I've laminated it, yes.
Yeah, who is it by?
And if you ask me this question, I can go on here
go
and
ahead.
Tell you.
Go ahead, yeah.
So you'd like to know the name of the linguist?
Because I want to use the one that is acceptable to you, not only to me.
To me? Do all linguists have the same message in each surah?
Sorry?
Does every single linguist in each surah have the exact put down the exact same message as all the other Qurans? In the exact same
I don't understand your question.
So this is from Dr. Mustafa Qatar.
Dr. Mustafa Qatar. Okay? Is that from the Clear Quran?
This is from the Clear Quran, yes.
Yeah, yeah. It's a very good translation.
Very good translation.
Right. So now, tell me. That's fine. So now, tell me. In the Quran.
In the Quran.
Using that translation that you are happy with, do you find inconsistencies within the Quranic?
Why are you asking me the questions? Why can't I be asking you the questions?
Okay, ask me the question.
Okay. So, in Surah 614.
Let me get this out.
Would you like me to read it out for you?
No, you
it
don't
says,
have to.
Shall I take for my protector any other than Allah, the maker of the heavens and the earth? And he is that feedeth, but is not fed. Say nay. Listen to this bit very carefully. But I am commanded to be the first of those who bow down to Allah in Islam. So submission to Allah. First. Do you agree? According to Tafsir Ibn Abbas, that's exactly what it is.
So,
submission to Allah. Bow down to Allah in submission.
So this surah
yes.
you've just read,
yes.
does it contradict with anything else within the Quran?
Within the Quran, no.
Right.
That is not
so,
the same.
So the Quran claims that if people reflected on the Quran deeply, with care, they would find that it doesn't have any contradictions or discrepancies.
I'm not disputing that the Quran has contradictions.
Right. So, let's talk about something else then.
What would you like to discuss? Because I've got my questions here and I would like to compare it.
So, since this subject is not about contradictions of the Quran, which you agree, the Quran is free from contradictions.
I never admitted that it's free from contradictions. I've just not yet found a contradiction.
Fair enough.
If I was to go on to Dr. David Woods,
that's fine.
17 Apologetics, I'm sure he would have gladly found a contradiction.
But you haven't found any. That's fine.
Personally, I haven't, because I've not actually looked for the contradiction.
No problem. No problem.
I've just looked
so,
at this verse
until,
and
until
I found
then,
a contradiction with one of your, what you call, authentic hadiths.
So hang on. The Quran doesn't say it is free from contradictions against the history, against this narration,
so
that
why
narration.
Why is it called Sahih? Why is it called authentic if it's contradicting?
Firstly,
that's my question to you.
Firstly, a Sahih hadith
yes.
would not contradict Quran.
It would not.
It would not. That's the principle.
It's not daif, right? It's not weak. It's
in principle, a Sahih hadith would not contradict the Quran.
In principle, as yes. in what? Could you elaborate?
That's what we were discussing earlier. We need to understand the principle. Because a Sahih hadith would not in principle contradict the Quran, because otherwise, you know, if he's saying something which goes against the Quran.
So do you accept there may be something in the Sunnah, in the Hadith, which may contradict the Quran?
There may be many statements attributed to the Prophet.
Yes.
In a number of collections,
right,
which may go against the Quran.
Which may go against
and
the Quran.
And if it does, then we know that this cannot be Sahih.
So then it won't be Sahih.
Yeah.
But you believe that Sahih Muslim is definitely an authentic Hadith?
Firstly.
Definitely, 100%.
Firstly.
Or are you following blindly your ulama?
Firstly,
okay.
Let's understand one thing. Collections of statements of the Prophet.
Right.
Is to understand what he said and what he did, right?
That's the Sunnah, yes, I understand that.
Right.
I'm not completely ignorant.
What is the prime or the most core message of Prophet Muhammad in his narrations?
Did you read his core message? That Allah is one God.
Allah says in the
Allah is one God and
belief in Allah and that he's the Prophet. What is it? The Shahada.
The core message is Allah is one God.
Yeah, what is it? The belief in the messengers. Among the dead. The six pillars of faith.
Wake up in the morning.
Belief in Allah. Belief in the angels.
And if you stay alive.
Belief in the messengers.
Mm-hmm.
Belief in the books. The Torah, the Injil.
Okay.
Stay for your health.
There's right. Six pillars of faith.
Right.
Very basic Islam.
Do you disagree with them?
Do I disagree in the point of view of a Muslim?
No. You, as a person.
Me, as what? Me as what?
As a person. As a person.
I disagree with what?
Your death.
Do you disagree with these teaching of Prophet Muhammad?
Do I disagree? Sallallahu
alayhi wa sallam.
Indeed. You do not know what you will be called.
Yes, I disagree with the teachers of Muhammad.
Can we move away from here because the brother is speaking, so we can go to one side?
Thank you. Absolutely. Thank
yeah.
you.
Okay.
What's the name of your team, right?
Mansour. I'm Mansour.
I couldn't see because you have the mask on, sir.
But that's not. Because we don't usually go by telling our names, right?
Well, personally, I don't.
Yeah, that's fine.
You may not, but personally, I don't.
I didn't say you're obliged to tell your name. I only asked. If you don't want to give your name, no problem.
Yeah, no, I disagree with that. I just asked what your name was and you said it was Hashim.
Mansour.
Apologies again.
No problem. So.
Thank you for the respect. I've had a couple of debates around here earlier on and I did not get the same respect you're giving to me, so I do appreciate that.
No problem. I just hope the people who are discussing with you, they should really, you know, get more elevated into the character a bit more.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
The enthusiasm, the character, exactly. I'm glad you've kind of understood the way that you give your dawah to people. Very good.
Okay.
I wish Christians could learn a thing or two from you.
Okay. Do you fundamentally agree with the teaching of Prophet Muhammad?
No.
Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Okay. Which no. ones in particular that you disagree?
Which ones don't I agree with?
Yeah.
Well, the teachings also being what he's done and that he didn't go against.
So when you say done, this is action. But in terms of his teachings, let's talk about the teachings and we can talk about the actions.
The actions, right. What do I agree with his teachings?
Yeah.
Do you mean the core teachings or all of his teachings?
No. We start with the core.
The core teachings.
And then we go into the
okay, so
the branches.
Okay, let's break it down. Do I believe in Allah? If Allah translates to my, does Allah include my God in your question?
Allah is the creator of the cosmos.
The cosmos. So in my view, it's the Trinitarian God. So yes, I do believe in the Trinitarian God. The Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Do I believe in the angels? I believe in Angel Jibreel. I believe in all the angels. Yes. Do I believe in what's the other one? All the books? No. I don't believe in the Quran as my authentic source. I'm not obliged to follow the Quran. Do I believe in the Old Testament? Yes, but I'm not obliged to follow the Old Testament and I don't eat shrimp, etc. I think you've heard this argument before. I believe Jesus completed, or should I say fulfilled, the Old Covenant into the New Covenant. So yes, I accept the New Testament, I accept the Old Testament. I don't accept the Quran. I accept the angels, I accept God.
Do you believe in hereafter?
Do I believe in the hereafter? So. In your eyes, it's Jannah and Jannah, heaven and hell.
Heaven and hell. Do you believe in heaven and hell?
I believe in heaven and hell, yes, according to my scriptures.
Okay. So when the Quran says God is one and only without any son or
I'm not
children.
Not going into a Trinitarian debate.
No. Core message of Islam. When it says there's no God worthy of worship except Allah.
Right.
And the Quran describes Allah is without a son,
without
a father, without any progeny, without any lineage, without any parents or forefathers, whatever it might be. So this is what the Quran describes and the Prophet explains this.
Yep, and you believe Isa, or shall I say Jesus Isa, is only a prophet, a messenger of Allah, he is not God.
Yeah.
Us Christians, I think you've heard before, believe he's the full revelation and manifestation of the invisible Father. He's claimed many times that he was, according to Christians. We're not getting into a Trinitarian debate, but you said what you believe. I'm not going to say what I believe.
So the disagreement seems to be the issues which clashes with your belief.
Which clashes in my beliefs. Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, fine. So when you go back to the religion of Abraham and Moses, for example.
And Moses and Musa.
Right, yeah.
Ibrahim and Musa.
Abraham and Musa, alayhi salam, peace be upon them, right? Alayhi salam. Do you believe their teaching about God is similar to yours or similar to the Muslims?
Yes, because Jesus did say before Abraham was, I am. So in other words, Jesus claiming to be God. What's the question again, sorry?
Do you believe the teachings about God the prophet Abraham and Moses is similar to what you believe as Christian or what Muslims believe in?
Definitely what I believe in.
Okay. So did you find a teaching within the teachings of Moses and Abraham where he describes God to be a Trinitarian God?
We're getting into the Trinity.
No, you don't have to go. No, you don't have to go to any argument for and against.
Is this just for the cameras?
It is simply saying, because when you say teachings about God,
the Trinity is the way you describe three in one and what the Christians believe. It doesn't specifically say Trinity in any of our books. We've heard this discussion time and time again.
It doesn't have to specify the word Trinity. Right?
It doesn't, right?
Yeah, conceptually.
Okay.
So, do you find Abraham and Moses upon them
neither of them talk about the coming of Muhammad, and
About God. Start with the concept of God. What are their understandings and teaching of God that they told their people to follow?
That God is one.
That's what Muslims say, God is one. So, I want to know, does it agree with more with your understanding of God or the Muslim understanding of God?
So what you're trying to do is say that, because you believe in Abraham and Moses, and we believe in Abraham and Moses, I'm going to try and make this claim that Abraham and Moses are closer to me. In other words, what you believe in is wrong and what I believe is wrong. Is that what you're trying to prove?
What we need to understand is, look, the prophets before Jesus Christ and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they existed before them, right? In terms of when they came to the people.
Yes.
Moses and Abraham, those prophets.
Correct.
And they were commissioned by God to tell people who God is.
Absolutely.
And they were one of the great and mighty prophets of God.
Yes.
Right. We're just trying to understand from your perspective and the Islamic perspective, what were their teachings about God?
They didn't talk about the Shahada.
No, what were the teachings about God?
The teachings about God.
Yes. You said they believed and told people about one God.
Yes.
Right.
And Christians believe there's one God.
Sure. But the oneness of God in Christianity and God.
Why are you always getting into the Trinitarian debate?
No.
Am I ever going to be able to ask you these questions like you interrupted me over there?
Remember.
Or are we going to go around the same things, the same hadith, as you do with everyone else?
The hadith of the Prophet, or the statement of the Prophet,
yes.
Centralizes.
Which hadith?
No. I'm going to ask the core hadith. Core.
Including?
The core hadith of the Prophet.
Ones?
I'm about to tell you. The core hadiths are the ones which are fundamentals to one to accept to become a Muslim.
And Shias will disagree. No, Shias will agree with you, but they take different hadiths as their core.
I don't have any Shia here to agree or disagree with them, so there's no point bringing Shia in here. It's unfair to bring Shia in when we don't have any Shia person to defend their
view.
Okay,
but you're both being Muslim. You're saying as a Muslim, you believe the core principles, but you believe in different core principles.
Core things, teachings, one must believe
to
even call themselves, label themselves as a Muslim.
Yes.
Right. So this teaching, I am saying, doesn't contradict, cannot and should not and would not contradict the Quran.
Right.
Now, is this teaching in any way different
from the teaching
that God is one
and
only, worthy of worship?
Yes.
Yep. And none else is worthy of worship.
Oh, that'll be shirk, right, in your religion?
Shirk is associating a partner with God.
Yeah, so more than one.
It's not more than one. You can associate.
You're searching a partner of God, associate, more than one God.
You can associate a tree with God and say, I worship the tree as well.
That's polytheism.
You make the tree as a partner to God.
Right.
But it doesn't make that tree to be God, right?
Right.
And it's not God's son or daughter.
Right.
So it's an association.
But Jesus says, honor me as you honor the Father. In other words, he's putting himself on the same level as God.
So,
because he is God.
So the idea of God and the concept of God,
yes,
according to Abraham and Moses,
yes,
let's understand a bit more about them.
Right.
So go ahead. So you mentioned about one God.
I did.
And what else did they talk about this one God?
What else do you talk about this one God? Who? Abraham and Moses?
Yeah.
You tell me.
I mean, I can tell you that they don't say that God is in any way another God before him, another God after him.
Right. And the Bible clears this. Just could you explain your religion? I'm not going to explain my religion, along with what you're saying is the standard. Mm-hmm. We believe Jesus, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the last. In other words, none after him and none before him.
Okay. So is there someone along with Jesus?
No.
So Jesus is the only God?
What do you mean the only God?
If you have Jesus, the Alpha and the Omega,
yes.
Remember...
Oh, is this going to be a Trinitarian debate?
No, no. Every time we want to understand the concept of God, you're just trying to somehow stop from going into a Trinitarian
debate. I'm not stopping anything.
Right.
I'm just asking.
We don't want to go into a Trinitarian debate if you don't want to.
If you don't want to?
Right.
I'm not saying I don't want to. I'm just asking
right.
if you...
So I'm simply saying the concept of God.
Right.
If God is one...
Yes.
You can call him, he's 3 in 1, 5 in 2, and 20 in million, whatever, right?
Right.
According to what God has said to his prophet.
Yes.
So according to what God has revealed to his prophet Moses and Abraham, did he reveal that he is one person or more than one person?
They don't specifically have to say something in order for it to be true later on.
Of course, God has conveyed the message about his
yes.
oneness, because it's quite clear. When, like, for example, in Isaiah...
which is why I then got to look at prophecies in the Old Testament.
In Isaiah, it's just like this. Before me, there was no God form.
Yes.
After me, there will be no God form.
Yes.
I alone am God, and there is none else.
None else.
Right. This is a God that is described about being how many? One.
Yes.
Right.
One God.
If someone says, I alone am God and there's none else,
yes.
Who is this I within the understanding that you have?
Who is this I?
Yeah.
What do you mean who is this I?
Because you believe God is we, right? And us.
We and us. There are three distinct persons in one divine essence. What is there not to understand? They do not share. They don't, it's not like 25% God here, 25% God here, or any other fraction. It's 100% God, 100% God, 100% God. They're all God, three in one. Three, not three gods, there's one God.
So if one of them said, I alone am God and there's none else.
One of them. You could have three, let me bring in an analogy.
Yeah, go ahead.
You're one human being. You're made up of a body, soul, and spirit. You're still one human.
Okay.
Even though you're one body, you've got a soul, obviously, and you've obviously got a spirit. And then you think about states of matter. This is another example.
Mm-hmm.
There's something called the triple point of water. So in the triple point of water, there can be a solid, a liquid, and a gas at one time. Still one state of, still there, still distinct states of matter, but they're three in one. What are they? States of matter, distinct, but one.
Okay.
Logically it makes sense, and mathematically, you're three-dimensional. Mathematically it makes sense, scientifically it makes sense, and spiritually it makes sense. Three can be one. My understanding, the Trinitarian understanding, the Christian understanding is three can be one. If you've got a Dewey Quran, a Wash Quran, an Afs Quran, if there are three different translations, it's still the Quran. Three can be one.
Sure. So when you have the Father saying, suppose the Father said, I alone am God and there is none else.
Yes.
Before me there was no one form, no God
yes.
form. After me, there's no God form.
Yes.
I alone am God and there is none else.
Are we getting another Trinitarian debate? We hear this all the time. It's the same arguments.
So
Yaya makes the arguments.
How do you understand?
Al-Dawah makes the arguments. Muhammad makes the arguments.
How do you understand
this? They've been refuted many times.
How do you understand this statement in Isaiah?
In Isaiah?
Yeah. When he says, I alone am God and there's none else. Who is this I?
Who is this I?
The language uses I rather than us.
Yes.
Who is it?
Well, I need to get the Bible verse up and have a look at it.
Okay.
I've come here with my questions and I've still not had any of my questions answered. We've gone straight to the Bible. As usual, the Dawah team in this park. You do it with Bob, you do it with Kay, you do it with all the other Christians in the park. You always go straight to the Bible. I want to talk to you about the Quran and you've gone straight to the Bible. Why can't we ever have a decent conversation about the Quran in this park? Why have you always got to drift off about the Bible?
Okay, there's lots of different verses, so...
We need
to go back to the Quran, right?
Back to the Quran.
Okay. This is not the one I was saying, but in Isaiah there's another verse like this. I am the Lord and there's no other.
Okay, so apart from capital law, that means Yah.
No, apart from me, there is no God. Me. Who is this me?
Who is this me?
Now, how do you understand this me? When he says, okay, so apart from me, there is no God. Okay, you can use which one you want.
There is no other apart from me.
English
no
standard
God.
Version. I'll strengthen besides
you,
me,
that you have not acknowledged me.
English standard version. Besides me, there is no God. New American. Besides me, there is no God. New King James. There is no God besides me.
Right.
King James. There is none else.
See,
no God
all translations say the exact same thing.
So who is this me?
Which means there's only one Bible.
So who is this me?
That's our argument.
Who is this me?
Dude, who's this me?
When God is saying no, God is the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit,
yeah,
you understand
God.
It?
That's God.
No. When he says me,
yeah.
Who is speaking here?
God.
God the who?
What do you mean God the who? There's only one God.
That's the
we've established, okay. I believe in one God, you believe Let in me one God. You've asked me who is this me, and
clarify,
I say it's God.
Clarify me
if
one
I
thing.
If I believe in one God and okay. I'm saying it's God, then it's one.
Can you
one
clarify
God.
Just one simple thing for me? Does the Father speak? Does the Son speak? Does the Holy Spirit speak? And
the
does
Trinitarian
the...
Wait. Again.
Please.
Aki, why are we always going to the Trinitarian
please.
Debate? Why can't I answer my question?
Okay, last question and we'll go to the Quran. So, the question is simple.
Right.
Who is speaking?
God.
Wait. Now I'm giving you something that you can tell me whether you agree with this or disagree with this. Either the Father is speaking, the Son is speaking, the Holy Spirit is speaking, or together as a Trinity they're speaking. Who's speaking?
God is speaking.
So, when you say God...
I believe in one God.
No,
God is speaking.
Listen. Whenever God speaks, God is either the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Jesus is the full revelation,
so,
the full manifestation of God. Whatever Jesus says, the Father is
so
saying,
whenever,
God, he is God. So, God is saying it.
Please, brother, thank you. Whenever God speaks, either... The Trinity itself speaks?
Yes, Jesus saying it, but he's just going to go off in this Trinity debate. I'm saying,
either,
which is why I then put on this argument.
No. Either the Trinity itself speaks, or the members of the Trinity...
This is not debunking the Christian faith. We believe there are three distinct personas.
I don't want to debunk anything.
You're not debunking anything.
I'm simply
good,
trying to...
Many do
I'm trying to see whether you understand that the concept of God, Prophet Muhammad SAW brought, whether it is similar to what Abraham and Moses brought.
Why are we going on? Why aren't we going to the questions that you interrupted me with over there? When
this
I'm
is going to be this is going to be the only question, and then we're going to go to the Quran.
Then why can't you answer
okay.
my question?
So let's finish this question, missionary.
Why couldn't we finish this question?
No. Let's finish the question about.
Why couldn't we finish this question?
As I said, you have loads of things to discuss, right?
One thing to discuss.
Okay, go ahead, and then we'll come back to that. Then right?
we come back to that.
Yeah.
Okay. So, as we established first and foremost, in Surah 6:14, it says, say, shall I take for my protector any other than Allah, the maker of the heavens and the earth, and he is feedeth, but is not fed? Say, nay, but I am commanded to be the first of those who bow to Allah in Islam, submission to Allah, Muslim, and be not thou of the company of those who join God with Allah, polytheism. Now, Tafsir ibn Abbas clearly makes it clear through the context of the person who's speaking is Muhammad, and he's talking about being commanded by Allah that he was the first Muslim and not to be of the polytheists. He was saying this to the Ummah, the community at Mecca at the time, right? And it does say among those who are among the Ummah, the community at the time. Now we look at Sahih Muslim 2659. Do you accept this as an authentic hadith? It says, the mother of every person gives him birth according to his true nature. It is subsequently his parents who make him a Jew or a Christian, two different religions, two different faiths, two different gods according to you. And had his parents been Muslim, he would have also remained a Muslim, meaning before they went off to Christianity or Islam, they were Muslims. Now the question to you is, Muhammad claimed to be the first Muslim in Mecca at the time in the Quran, but the hadith is saying everyone is born a Muslim at all times, meaning that Muhammad cannot have been the first Muslim in Mecca if there are Muslims or submission to Allah before him. So my question to you is, do we trust the Quran or what you see as being an authentic hadith?
Okay. So the hadith that you read from here, what is it trying to say?
What is it trying to say?
I need to understand what you understand from it. What is it trying to say?
Explain the context.
Hmm?
I explain the context to you. He's talking about fitra.
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 Okay.
Everyone's born a Muslim according to you.
Does it say according to everyone born a Muslim or
so,
everyone
so you
born
don't believe that everyone's born a Muslim?
No.
You don't believe everyone's born a Muslim.
I haven't answered anything. I'm
no,
simply
but
saying.
That's my question. Don't you believe
but
in autonomous?
For me to answer,
yes,
is what you're quoting here. I need to understand what you're saying. Does this hadith say everyone is born in a fitra, or does it say everyone is born as a Muslim?
It says that it's apparent that Muslim who also remained a Muslim.
So, how is everyone born in the fitra or in the Muslim, in the Islamic disposition?
What do you mean? Islamic disposition.
What is the fitra according to the hadith?
According to the hadith, the fitra is everyone being born a Muslim.
No, no. What
is that pure?
What is the fitra?
The fitra.
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Precisely. What is the fitra?
What is the fitra? What do you mean, what is the fitra? You asked me the question.
So you don't know? I can tell you.
Yeah,
fitra is the natural, innate disposition to worship one God and accept one God.
Yeah.
Okay? That's the innate natural disposition.
Fair enough.
That's the fitra. Everyone is born with that.
Everyone's born with submitting to Allah.
Everyone is born with that natural, innate disposition.
So they're born a Muslim. It says here, it subsequently his parents who make him a Jew or a Christian. Had his parents been a Muslim, he'd also remained a Muslim.
Okay. I need to read the Arabic of this to see how this is translated, because
like
I know.
Get it up on your phone. I can tell you the verse.
No, why don't you bring it up on your phone?
On my phone.
Yeah.
From sunnah.com.
Okay. And where's the hadith? This is the.
Oh.
Okay, let's read it.
Would you like to read out in Arabic?
Okay, here. حدثنا قتيبة بن سعيد حدثنا عبد العزيز يعني الدروردي عن العلاء عن أبي هريرة أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال كل إنسان تلده أمه على الفطرة وأبواه بعد يهودانه وينصرانه ويمجسانه فإن كان مسلمين فمسلم كل إنسان تلده أمه يلكظه الشيطان في حضنيه إلا مريم وابنها. Okay. So here, look. So as it says, these are the people who narrated this, and Prophet said, every human being, تلده أمه, mother gave birth, and al-fitra in this natural disposition, and the parents then. They make them Jewish or Christian or Majusi. فَإِنْ كَانَ مُسْلِمَيْنِ If the parents were Muslim, then the child remains a Muslim.
Remains a Muslim.
No. Because the parents are identifying the child to be a Muslim. They call them my son or my son.
There's a definition of Muslim.
Listen.
And the definition of Muslim is submission to Allah. They will have also remained submitting to Allah.
When a child is identified in a Christian family, they don't say this child is a Muslim. Do they identify as a Muslim?
What do you mean to identify as a Muslim? We don't believe as Christians that
when a Jewish person, family, mom and dad, has a child, do they identify that child to them and their family and the community that child is a Muslim?
So could you read the last part again? It says they would have also remained a Muslim. It doesn't say the parents would have called them a Muslim.
Because
it doesn't matter what the parents call them, it's what they are.
It's all about identifying who they are.
It doesn't say that.
Look, if there are others,
what they are.
No, if their parents are Muslim,
yes,
then they will call and label
the
child.
It doesn't say that they'll be called that.
That's what the hadith, in my understanding, indicates.
But that's not what I understand. So what do we do?
Very good. When we have a misunderstanding or difference in understanding,
yes,
you should go to a commentary of this hadith.
The commentary of the hadith?
Yeah.
By who? Who makes the commentary?
By hadith scholars.
Hadith scholars?
Yeah.
But scholars have different opinions depending on which scholar you follow. What do you mean?
This is...
What I'm saying is simple. Aki,
now take your phone.
Okay, listen to me please, just very quickly.
This hadith is narrated
I don't trust the scholars. Do you know why? Because not all Sunni Muslims believe in what Yasir Qadhi says.
You can believe
or trust... Because a lot
of
people condemn Yasir Qadhi. He said different things to what other Sunni Muslims say.
That's up to you to trust or not, right?
Yeah, so Muslims believe different things.
So when we have a hadith in Sahih Muslim, we have commentary on Sahih Muslim.
Yeah.
So, if you haven't done so, I can only suggest that you do. Go and read the commentary and see whether the commentary agrees with the understanding that I have or you have.
So basically, at this point we are where we are right now, you could be right or I could be right. But we can't both be right. There's one objective truth,
at this
right?
point, there's a difference in our understanding of this hadith.
In our understanding. Because we're human beings, you have different understandings. We interpret things differently.
So it is only beneficial that you go to
commentary. As a Muslim doing dawah, you can't tell me specifically what this actually means.
Look.
You can't convince me on the spot now what this means.
I can tell you, but you disagree like you've done, right?
Because it doesn't say that.
And when you say it doesn't say that, you're just going by the reason why. This is another principle I'm establishing here. Will you? Okay. Whenever a text is in dispute or in question, what one should go to the original text in the original language.
So you're saying that Allah can only communicate to the people in Arabic.
No.
You said you must go to the original language.
Listen.
Allah can only communicate to the people in Arabic.
If there is a dispute over a text,
then you must go to the original language, meaning that Allah can only communicate to you perfectly in Arabic.
I don't understand what you're saying. If
now you don't understand what I'm saying. Did you hear that? I don't understand what you're saying.
No, what I'm saying is...
Is what you've told everyone in the past?
I am misunderstanding...
Aki, please, would you like me to repeat myself again?
I am misunderstanding...
Oh, don't you
I am misunderstanding
it?
One thing.
Because Allah can only speak to you in Arabic perfectly.
Suppose there's a text in the Bible.
So Allah can only speak to you perfectly in Arabic and any other language.
If I explain that to you, maybe you can help me understand it, right?
Because Allah can only speak to you in Arabic and any other language.
Suppose
he can only speak to you in Arabic and any other language perfectly.
If I make my point, maybe you can help me understand it, right?
Can he or can he not?
I'm trying to say something,
right?
And in return, you can help me understand it, right?
Help you understand the hadith.
Help me understand the issue here.
The issue here? So you want to go away from the fact that Allah can only communicate to you in Arabic?
You see, we're talking about...
Allah can only communicate to you
in
Arabic.
We're talking about...
And my God can communicate to all of us in different languages.
We are talking about, do you agree, a dispute in understanding a particular text.
Right.
That text could be a text which is legal.
It can be.
It could be medical.
Right.
It could be theological, whatever, right?
But this is a hadith in the religion.
Right. So do you agree that when there is a dispute in such a text,
the Quran one says, "I have perfected this religion for you and completed your blessings upon you."
Do you agree?
What is your understanding of that verse?
Do you agree one should?
That has perfected and completed in what language?
Look,
Arabic.
Look, we can go to that. But you don't want to, though. No, as you can see, I have some deficiency in understanding the issue, right?
So, yes. Yeah, so
not you. I have a deficiency.
So, what does the Quran say?
So, I'm trying to get some help from you.
Right?
I'm trying to get some help from you so you can help me understand the issue, right? Right. So you know there are Jehovah's Witness Christians.
They use
John 1:1 and say it doesn't mean this is.
They've got a different Bible. We can trace where the Bible was changed.
Listen,
they're heretics. According to
Jehovah's
most Christians,
Jehovah's Witnesses,
the heretics. Yep.
They use John 1:1 from the Greek.
They distort the Bible.
No, it's the same Greek language.
Same Greek language, but different words. They distort the Bible. They are heretics.
No,
Mansoor,
the word,
they distort the Bible.
Maybe they do, but I'm saying...
I don't want to speak
for... No, I'm saying John 1-1.
I don't want to slander the Jehovah's Witnesses.
John,
I'm telling you they are heretics.
John 1.
They are heretics. They changed the writing. You can trace where they were changed.
If you want to consider them to be heretics, you're entitled to it.
Yes.
But I'm simply
because
saying...
Because they've changed the words. What else can we say?
Have they
if you change the word of God, they are heretics.
Have they changed the Greek text of John 1:1? Or do they use the same Greek text that you use?
I don't know. I'm not a Jehovah's Witness.
Right.
I just know what they've done in the past.
As far as I know, they use the same Greek text.
Do they?
Yes. So now you realize the point that I'm trying to understand, right? Remember, I'm trying to understand, not you. Greek same text is understood differently by Trinitarians and the Jehovah's Witness.
But we don't need to go to another language in order to understand it.
No,
like it Muslims do, because you're
what I am saying. Would you agree?
Arabization.
Would you agree
that?
Would you agree?
Arabic name.
Listen. Would you agree? When there's a dispute in understanding a text, firstly we have to go to the original.
Right.
We have no
problem. According to you, because your God can only communicate to you in Arabic.
Okay. Do you know there's one Bible translation in which Jesus says, "I am the living God"?
Which translation was this?
There's one translation.
Can you tell me the translation?
I can't remember. I can bring
you can't
it up.
Remember.
No. I've just recently read. Okay.
That's interesting. It's new knowledge for me.
Right.
Which translation?
It's not something that is common. It's not a common translation.
It's a controversial subject. Can you please wait?
Look.
I'm a Christian. I would like to know.
I am saying.
Is it because you don't know? Can you please tell me the translation?
I can bring
You've
this
made
up.
A claim. Please give me the translation.
Listen. I can.
Aki, give me the translation.
Okay.
Thank you. It's new knowledge for me. I'd rather know.
What I'm trying to say is this particular translation doesn't go with other translations where Jesus doesn't say, "I'm the living God." So I'm saying, when a translation says, Jesus says, "I'm the living God."
You want to know when it was written and what has been changed. We can trace when it was changed. You can't with Arabic. You've got
this,
to go to a different
this
language.
Translation,
that is the difference. You can't keep comparing.
This translation.
I see what you're doing, Mansour.
I am saying this translation.
I can see what you're doing.
This translation is in favor of you or favor of me?
What do you mean is it in favor of you?
Whose favor is it?
Which translation? That I don't know what translation you're talking about.
A
you're
particular
not
translation
me.
That I'm
show
about to bring. Look, I'm about to bring.
Show me the translation.
I'm about to bring it up.
Just get up.
Patience.
I'm patient.
Is this
I have sabr, don't worry. Can you
is this translation in favor of you or favor of me?
I don't know, I've not heard the translation.
What did I say the translation says?
I want to know. I can't take your word for it. Unless you can show me, I can't believe
it. Okay, you know what? Let's find it, okay?
Let's find it. Well done, brother. You're getting somewhere.
I am the living God. Right?
Tell me the translation.
This is what Jesus says.
Because I can guarantee there are translations before that which have maintained what's dated back to the early manuscripts. I don't believe it. I believe Jehovah's Witnesses are heretics.
Oh, there's a translate. Thank you. Walking Bible. Lex, it's like God sends divine help.
Please get
Barakallahu feek. You know, there's a translation, Ethiopic or Aramaic or something, which says, "I am the living God." There's a translation they use in a verse that he uses. That he says, "I am the living God." Jesus is saying, "I am the living God." In that particular translation.
Yeah, Matthew.
Okay. Okay. He's gonna find this verse.
It's Aramaic.
It's an Aramaic one. Yeah. Correct. It's an Aramaic translation.
Aramaic. One.
Aramaic. They translated.
Do you know what language the Bible was written in?
Which part of the Bible?
What are you talking about?
Matthew.
Are you talking about Matthew?
It's.
I don't know what one you're talking about, which is why I'm asking you to bring it up.
This one.
So it's Matthew 14:27 in the Aramaic Bible.
Right.
Okay. They've translated to say Jesus is saying, "I am the living God." So this is the reference. Matthew 14:27 in the Aramaic translation to English.
The Aramaic translation.
Yeah. They're translating from the Aramaic to English. Or they translated in Aramaic.
It's not an accurate translation.
We know it's not. So the point I was trying to make is
the Bible is not mentioned in Aramaic, that's just what Jesus spoke.
So the point I was trying to make is when there is a translation and it says something and there's a dispute, did Jesus say, "I'm the living God" or not?
You're putting the standard of the hadith to the Bible. That is not what we
text. Any text in dispute?
Any text.
Like the hadith? Or the Quran or the Bible? We should go to the original language, right? It's written in.
The original language is not Aramaic.
Whatever that language is.
But you're talking about an Aramaic translation. The original language is not Aramaic, and so, I'm not a Jehovah's Witness.
So they should go to the original language that it's written
That's
in.
That's why I consider them as heretics, is what they're saying as well.
Right. So you agree then? We should go to...
Christians.
We should go... This is not a Jehovah's Witness translation, by the way.
You said it was Jehovah's Witness before this.
Not this one.
Not this one.
I was
so you're talking about something different.
I was saying John 1:1.
John 1:1.
Jehovah's Witnesses have a different understanding
heretics,
than
yeah.
yours. Right, okay. So, we in principle agree.
Can you get John 1:1 up from the Jehovah's Witnesses Bible? I've not seen it.
You can do that yourself.
What do you mean I can do that myself? Can you show me now? You've made the claim, show me.
Nazem. John 1:1 in the Jehovah's Witness translation.
I'm not a Jehovah's Witness and it dates back.
A word is it? Oh, no, a God.
The original Greek that they use. Do they use a different Greek?
No, it's the same Greek.
It's the same Greek. That's my point. So, not only that we have to go to the original language when there's a dispute, the point I'm alluding to from this example is, even the same text may have differences of...
Then why is it all the other Christians managed to get the words right other than the heretics?
When exactly. There is a dispute, you have to now then go to commentaries to see...
The language.
They didn't distort the language.
The words.
They did not in that verse.
They're not in that verse.
They did not.
Because there's no definite article. Hmm?
So what are you trying to compare?
It's the same thing, but the different understanding.
The understanding's different.
Yeah. So what's the point I was trying to make? That you helped me to understand.
So, what?
You've helped me to understand something. Thank you for that. So what was the...
About the commentary.
No, what was the point that I was trying to make which you did help me to understand?
What point?
Yeah.
What point did I say that?
You just helped me for that.
Loads of points.
On that point about
the fact that when
there's a dispute in a text, that we should go to not only the original, but also once we have the original, we have to understand the original from the scholarly works.
Scholarly works.
Right.
But we're in agreement with ourselves.
So then you go to the scholarly works.
You have different ideas, you have the same Bible, it's just that then this heretic Bible is completely different to all of ours.
Okay. So when Abraham believed in one God,
When are we gonna get onto this?
But we have come to a stalemate here because.
Do you want some hanjo?
I'm fine, thank you. When we are discussing
this hadith
about when the child is with a Muslim parent,
yes,
and they remain a Muslim or they are identified as a Muslim,
absolutely,
and you are saying your understanding,
there's no identification here.
Yeah, it's different. I am saying
it's not an understanding, it's a fact. There's nothing talking about identification. It's saying what they were previously, and what they were previously were Muslims. That's exactly what it's saying.
Yeah. So I am saying next step for you is to go into a commentary.
A commentary.
Because you are not taking my explanations. So you should go to a commentary from a scholarly commentator.
But may I ask, why should I go to a commentary when scholars are in disagreement with each other? Yasser Kadi says one thing, other scholars say another thing.
Okay.
Some scholars believe that there's holes in the narrative, other scholars believe there isn't.
So how do you...
Which scholar do we believe
in? So basically, are you suggesting that you don't read any scholarly works on the Bible? Because there are differences between them?
Well, the heretics have a different understanding of the Bible, yes.
And apart from the heretics?
We're in agreement.
Good. So you can leave the heretical... scholars.
Right.
Good, so we've established another principle. Thank you for that. You know,
you're very welcome, brother.
That's fine with COVID-19, but you're brilliant. You're helping me understand a lot of things.
No problem.
So when there's a dispute, you go to the original language, original text, and then even if there's a misunderstanding or difference of understanding, we go to scholarly works on them and we leave the heretical scholarship.
Right. And are you saying my understanding is a heretical
I'm not saying your understanding is heretical. I'm saying we should go to scholarly works on the hadith on Muslim, commentary on Muslim.
Even though your scholars don't agree with each other.
You just established that we can leave the heretical scholars.
But how do we do that for Muslims? I know how we do it as Christians, but it's different.
So if a scholar says, I believe Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadian is a prophet after Prophet Muhammad, you would know according to Islam this is a heretical. Just like
according to your...
We would say this is heretical. But if you have a scholar, like say the scholar's name is someone, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, for example. And if he's agreed upon by all Muslims and considered to be a scholar on this subject.
All Muslims, well not all Muslims are going to believe in one
scholar. Apart from the heretics.
Again, it doesn't work like that.
We can identify who the heretics are, do you agree?
Depending on which sect you're from.
Can you identify in Christianity who the heretics are?
Well, if one Bible, which is written hundreds of years later as a translation, separate from all the other Bibles which are in agreement with the manuscripts, then yes.
So you can identify who the heretics are.
You can't keep putting the standard of the Bible to the Quran and the Hadith.
No, I am saying to understand who the heretics are, you can identify them.
But it's different in Islam and Christianity.
It may be different. It may be different,
yes.
But still there are ways to identify them. The heretics from the Orthodox one.
Different ways.
Right. So we apply the methodology that identifies a scholar from heretics.
So how do Muslims identify them?
So when the Quran describes...
The Hadith, I'm talking about Hadith.
When the Hadith describes something, and a heretical scholar says, I do not believe Prophet Muhammad as the last prophet of God, then you would know that
has
this is...
Has any scholar said that?
I'm saying that to you.
But no scholar has ever said that, so we can't use that as an example.
Do you know the Ahmadis and the Qadianis?
The what, sorry?
The people, the group of people, they are called Ahmadi.
Oh, the Ahmadiyya.
Yeah, very good.
Don't they believe in that guy?
I tell you, this man is quite knowledgeable.
Don't they believe in that guy for the 20th century?
Yes.
The early 20th century, yeah. This guy just kept the sect in India.
Yes.
Yeah, I think I know.
So this Ahmadiyya...
Oh, the Sufis who go round and round and round all the time.
They're not Ahmadiyya, they're different. So the Ahmadiyyas, they believe that Prophet Muhammad is not the final prophet. They believe someone else after him. So according to the standards within the hadith, the statements and teachings, we can say that criteria safely will demonstrate that this is a heretical scholar or a person.
Absolutely.
Fine. So do you have any other questions on this? Because we've moved into a point where we have to go to the scholarly works on it.
I've learned quite a lot from you. And
me too.
You've learned a lot
Thank
from
you.
Me
yes, me too. Thank you. Do you have anything else?
I really need to speak to Bob right now. I need to sign my DRV.
That's fine.
A pleasure to speak
That's
with
fine.
You.
Okay, you take care. Okay? And we.
COVID.
That's okay. And we have to speak again, right?
Absolutely.
You take care. Okay?
Assalamu alaikum. Express